Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining. We have Dr. Moore here today, so I'll turn it over to him for some brief remarks.
Good afternoon, bon après-midi. I want to first begin by thanking Ontarians for all the sacrifices they have made so far this winter. You have shown yourselves to be adaptive and resilient, and your efforts have been and are essential protecting our healthcare system. Based on the experiences in other jurisdictions and judging from when Omicron first emerged in Ontario, we can anticipate that the transmission of Omicron may peak in the next few weeks. En se basant sur la situation dans d'autres pays et en jugeant la situation depuis l'apparition d'Omicron en Ontario, nous pouvons prévoir que la transmission d'Omicron pourrait atteindre un pic dans les prochaines semaines. This will be followed by subsequent increases in hospitalizations and ICU admissions, which typically occur 1 to 2 weeks after infection. So it will be a difficult January, but the sacrifices you are making now means a better February and then a better March for all of us. One important way to blunt the impact of Omicron is through vaccination. La vaccination est un moyen important d'atténuer l'impact d'Omicron. I am pleased to see that over 29 million doses of a COVID-19 vaccine have been administered in Ontario, and over 5 million of those are booster doses. It's particularly important to receive your booster dose if you are over 50, immunocompromised, or pregnant. But COVID-19 vaccines are important to us all. This virus is not one that only impacts the old and the vulnerable. If you haven't booked your booster dose appointment, please do so as soon as possible. 84 days after your last dose makes you eligible. And if there is an opportunity for you to rebook your COVID-19 vaccine appointment earlier than your current scheduled date, whether for your first or second dose or for your booster, please do not hesitate to do so. There are empty seats in some of our vaccination clinics. More and more walk-in appointments are being made available, and we have capacity should you wish to book an earlier appointment, whether through a pharmacy, your local public health unit, through the vaccine portal, or via your healthcare provider. Il y a des rendez-vous qui ne sont pas honorés et deviennent libres dans certaines de nos cliniques de vaccination. De plus en plus de visites sans rendez-vous sont disponibles et nous avons la capacité d'accommoder les changements de rendez-vous pour ceux qui voudraient modifier leur date de rendez-vous à une date antérieure, que ce soit auprès d'une pharmacie, d'un bureau de santé publique, sur le portail de prise de rendez-vous de l'Ontario ou par l'intermédiaire de votre fournisseur de soins d'une santé primaire. And as a reminder, both Moderna and Pfizer are equally good and provide strong protection against COVID-19 and its variants. So please take the first vaccine available to you. In fact, Moderna is recommended for those who are older as it has robust and prolonged protection. It is as effective, or in some studies, more effective at protecting against hospitalization than the Pfizer vaccine. It's also safe and effective to receive what we call a mixed dose series, or a first, second, and third dose of COVID-19 vaccines that are not the same vaccine brand. The science is clear. The more of us with a booster dose, the less of us will end up in the hospital and the intensive care unit. Given the rapid rate of transmission and the strain on our healthcare system, we have been busy providing fourth doses in long-term care homes, retirement homes, elder care lodges, and other congregate settings to best protect our most vulnerable citizens. And we are now protecting vulnerable populations further in Ontario. We've already asked that severely to moderately immunocompromised individuals receive three doses as their primary series of the COVID-19 vaccine. But we are now ensuring that those who are immunocompromised can receive their fourth dose too. Mais nous veillons désormais à ce que les personnes immunodéprimées puissent également recevoir leur quatrième dose. Beginning tomorrow, January 14th at 8 a.m., Provincial Vaccine Contact Center will be able to handle appointment bookings for fourth doses for immunocompromised individuals. However, there is another group that is still lagging in terms of taking up their booster doses. It's estimated that only 64% of eligible organ transplant recipients have received even their third dose. So whether it's your third or your fourth dose, those who are immunocompromised are strongly encouraged to make an appointment and benefit from the protection the vaccine provides. You can receive your fourth dose shots 84 days after your third dose. We are doing well in protecting younger Ontarians from COVID-19, and currently 47.9% of children have received their first dose, but we all want to see that number continue to climb. The pediatric Pfizer vaccine is for children 5 to 11 is safe, it's effective, and provides strong protection against COVID-19 and its variants. Side effects in children 5 to 11 years of age are similar to those seen in adults and older children. These side effects include sore arm, fatigue, headache, muscle pain, joint pain, fever, and chills in a small percentage of individuals, which is very common in all vaccines administered for children. Typically, these side effects will go away after a few days, and there are no long-term side effects reported. Rare side effects that have been seen in older teens and young adults are expected to be extremely rare in children. Although severe illness due to acute COVID-19 infection is less frequent in children compared to adults, children can still be hospitalized and even require admission to an intensive care unit and can develop other complications from COVID-19 beyond the infection itself. So I strongly encourage all children 5 to 11 to get the vaccine as soon as possible. Donc, je recommande fortement que les enfants de 5 à 11 ans se fassent vacciner dès que possible. It's also important to remember that our youngest Ontarians, those 4 and younger, can't be vaccinated because there's no vaccine available for them yet. The best way to protect them is by ensuring that everyone around them is vaccinated. This will reduce the likelihood of our youngest Ontarians ending up in hospital with a COVID-19 complication. Vaccination, coupled with the additional protective measures currently in place, remain important to safeguard children's health during this current winter wave. We are also hopeful that we'll begin to receive oral outpatient antiviral treatments in the next few weeks. However, supply will be limited and we will be prioritizing certain populations at highest risk for severe outcomes for this medication. This winter has been tough and we are not yet out of the woods, but through continued vaccination efforts, we can ensure that our healthcare system can function and keep up with the demands placed upon it by COVID-19. We can protect Ontarians and help save lives. Mais en continuant nos efforts de vaccination, nous pouvons faire en sorte que notre système de santé puisse fonctionner et répondre aux demandes imposées par la COVID-19. Nous pouvons protéger les Ontariennes et Ontariens et contribuer à sauver des vies. Thank you and merci.
Go to the phone lines. Just a reminder, one question, one follow-up. Over to the first question, please.
From Chris Glover at CBC News. Please go ahead.
Hey there, Dr. Moore. Thank you so much for taking our questions, as always. I wanted to start with some harsh criticisms that we're hearing today from Ontario's business community. They're telling me that they feel they don't have clarity on when restrictions are going to lift or what specific metrics you and the government are watching to even make that decision. So what can you tell them about the likelihood of whether restrictions will lift on January 26th? And can you also explain what specific threshold needs to be met for specific indicators like hospitalizations or ICU occupancy or whatever indicator it is that you're watching for, that you would give that advice to the province that it's time to lift restrictions?
Well, thank you so much, Chris, for that question. And I'm sorry, I know these are very difficult times. I'm very sorry that these measures have to be placed on businesses. And absolutely, it's our intent to keep them as short as possible. The key metrics that we're watching and working with the health system is to monitor how many patients in intensive care, how many patients overall in hospital, how well they can be provided care, given that many businesses now are having high absenteeism. It's certainly a major factor for our healthcare system now that workers are catching Omicron, have to stay home. And that is our key metric. We need, as a society, to continue to protect the healthcare system to care for Ontarians who get sick from this virus. As well, we're monitoring other metrics, such as the percentage of positive tests that are now being collected through the PCR system. And we're working at modeling using some of these numbers through our expertise at Public Health Ontario and within the ministry to be able to predict when we're going to see any further clarity on Omicron decreasing and having a decreasing impact on our lives in our healthcare system. So I absolutely appreciate their concern. You have our conviction that we want these to be as short as possible to only protect the health system so that we can provide care to Ontarians when they need it, where they need it. We don't have great clarity yet, given that the numbers of people in the health system continue to increase day after day. I'm looking for a plateau and a peak. And then we want to slowly and cautiously remove public health measures so that we don't have a rebound in cases coming into our hospital system. Ontarians have been so brilliant at adhering to the best practices, coming forward to get vaccinated. This time is also a time where we need all Ontarians to get their booster doses, which will further protect the healthcare system from getting inundated. I think we have a significant amount of work to do yet to get boosters in the arms of 50 and over. And you heard my call today. We need 50 and over to get immunized. We need those that are immunocompromised, that are transplant patients, as well as our children to get their first and their second doses. All of that will help us get through this quicker so that we can get back to our new normal of graded and cautious reopening heading into the spring. But I hear their sentiment. I understand their concerns. And absolutely, we want to be able to give them clarity, but we don't have it yet. We'll watch the data very closely. We're reviewing it absolutely every single day. I think we'll get greater clarity next week if we're going to plateau with our intensive care unit and hospitalization data.
Follow up?
Yeah, okay. So I'm not sure I totally heard how likely you think it is for the restrictions to lift on January 26th. So if you could answer that in the follow-up here, that would be great. But you also mentioned next week, and I was speaking with the scientific director of Ontario's COVID advisory table today, and he told me that it's looking like Omicron's hospitalization peak could be as early as next Tuesday. So I'm curious, is that what you're seeing as well? And then, of course, how quickly after the peak would you allow for restrictions to lift?
So we're monitoring that same data, and I'm hoping as well. We saw a sudden rise of admissions to hospital in the intensive care unit, I think secondary to the holiday season. Our public health measures have just been put in on the 5th. We should start to see that benefit of the sacrifices that Ontarians have made next week. And I do agree, early in the week, we should be able to get clarity on where we're at. And as soon as we have clarity, we want to inform the business community. So I can't guarantee the 26th. Please stay tuned. We'll be watching the same data as those experts at the science table, and we collaborate with them to be able to inform public health measures. But I hear the sentiment. No one likes having to impose public health measures. I hope all Ontarians understand the reasons we had to put them in place. And I deeply appreciate the sacrifices that the businesses are making. And you have our commitment to be as transparent as we can as the data becomes available. And I do think early next week, we'll have some greater clarity on how Ontario is doing with this significant Omicron wave.
Next question.
From Rob Ferguson at the Toronto Star. Please go ahead.
Hi, Doctor. I'm wondering, when you say slowly decrease the public health measures so we don't have a rush, what do you think that you would ease first, or would you ease everything that is now in place in stages?
I think what's worked really, thank you for that question, Rob. What's worked well for Ontario is our slow and cautious approach. A sudden reopening, I'd be very worried about another wave of Omicron. So we anticipate as we headed into this, we had slow incremental decreases in capacity for those venues that were affected. We anticipate reopening in a staged and phased manner. Usually the 2 week period gives us clarity on how we're doing as we further open up areas of the economy. So do anticipate, this is clearly direction from government that has to make this call, but we would make recommendations of how we've worked in the past, phased, staged, 2 week time periods, typically of reopening to ensure that we don't have a rebound in cases and a sudden impact again on the healthcare system. So that would be the typical process and phases that we'd go in.
Follow up.
All right, thank you. And can you give us a little more detail on who are these immunocompromised people that can start getting fourth shots tomorrow? Just be more specific, please.
Okay, so anyone that's a transplant patient, those patients are on immunosuppressant medications. They absolutely, we would like three doses as their primary series, and then 84 days after can get their booster dose. There is a long list of medications on the Ontario.ca website that are immune suppressants. Typical immune suppressants are used for patients with rheumatoid arthritis, with ulcerative colitis, with severe lung disorders such as steroids, that list is quite extensive, so I don't want to repeat it here, but anyone that's on that list of medications and or has those types of diagnoses would be eligible for the three dose primary series and the fourth dose 84 days after their last. So we can send you that link, Rob, to ensure if you're reporting on this, that it's quite an extensive list of medications for the common severe illnesses like rheumatoid arthritis, like colitis, Crohn's disease, and other autoimmune disorders.
Next question.
From Colin DeMello at CTV News. Please go ahead.
Hey, good afternoon, Dr. Moore. I have a couple of education-related questions. So educators are getting N95 masks, but students are not. I'm wondering if you can address that discrepancy. Whose decision was it to give students 3-ply masks rather than N95 masks? And do you believe that students should be getting N95 masks for maximum protection?
The recommendations for the use of masks typically comes from our education committee, which is medical officers of health in partner with infection prevention control experts in partnership with the Ministry of Education. Just to be clear, it's non-fitted N95 masks have been offered to workers. From an equity vantage point, we wanted the highest grade masks that we could provide to children that could be properly fitted. So the Ministry of Education has purchased those masks, which aligns with Public Health Ontario's recommendations on masks for children, as well as the Public Health Agency of Canada's. So a 3-ply mask will be provided to all children as a means of equity to ensure that all children are offered the same high quality mask. The delivery of N95, I don't believe we have pediatric N95 masks to be able to deliver, but that is something we can review.
Follow up?
Thank you. And a lot of people are wondering about boosters for the 12 plus population. I believe they were first eligible for their doses back in May. So it's been quite a length of time. When will children 12 plus be eligible for a booster?
So thank you, Colin. Again, that's a great question. We're finding that in the adolescent population, the 12 to 17, two doses is significantly still protective against admission to hospital and severe outcomes. When we've looked at recent data from the federal government for the last month of admissions to hospital for that age group, a 7 times higher risk of being admitted to hospital if you're unvaccinated in that age group versus vaccinated. So that's telling us, despite only having two doses, there's still ongoing protection for that population against severe outcomes, which is very good news. The National Advisory Committee on Immunization continues to monitor, has not recommended a booster in that population yet, nor has our Ontario Immunization Advisory Committee suggested a booster is necessary, given the high levels of protection we're currently seeing against severe outcomes. So that will be, that data will be monitored. Those recommendations will be reviewed on a regular basis, but at present, there's been no recommendation for a booster yet for either population. Now, for immunocompromised children, we do believe the subsequent doses would be beneficial. And they should seek guidance from their healthcare provider who provides care for them for their immunocompromised state. And they should follow those recommendations for that population.
Next question.
From Mark Douglas at City News 680. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Dr. Moore, you mentioned the key metrics that you're watching to wrap up the stage two rollback on January 26th. What's the biggest risk to those hospitalization numbers shooting way up to prevent that reopening and the ending of stage two? What's really going to take us off the rails here?
What would take us off the rails if we don't maintain that the booster doses? The booster dose for 50 and over and for immunocompromised is really essential. We're seeing that it maintains that protective benefit against hospitalization. And I really very much appreciate 150,000 Ontarians almost daily now are coming forward primarily for their third doses. Children continue to come for their first and second doses. But we need to continue that momentum of third doses that prevent hospitalization. That was one of the major targets over the last several weeks, is continue to immune boost to prevent individuals from the need or requirement to be admitted to hospital. So together, that's an important metric that we're monitoring that will help us not have a rebound in admissions as we remove public health measures, and will be very important for all of us to continue to protect each other by having the highest immunity we can achieve through that third dose. So please, I think you've heard this message loud and clear from me. Third dose is absolutely essential. 84 days from your last dose makes you eligible. If you've got an appointment in March, appointment in February, please, if it's 84 days, you're eligible today. There's walk-ins now more available. Our pharmacies have more appointments, and so do our public health clinics. Take advantage of them and get protected now rather than waiting. Rebook your appointment if it's 84 days would be my key message. That will prevent a rebound in admissions, will continue to protect Ontarians against this virus, and together protect our health system.
Follow up.
Thank you. Dr. Moore, you say the ending of the stage two rollback is going to be something that will be staged and phased. From a medical point of view, what should open first and what needs to open last as the province phases out of the modified stage two?
So we're going to make recommendations to government, and these are government decisions. I want to make that clear. But as we moved in to the public health measures, we would reverse out. So the last thing to open would be mass gatherings of 20,000 people in a stadium, because those can be super spreading events. We would open all of those that we first closed the 5th of January, and then do staged and phased reopening, with the mass gatherings being the last. And I do believe the government wants to do this in a slow, staged and phased approach. It is the eventual decision of government on how this is done.
Next question.
From Allison Jones at the Canadian Press. Please go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Moore. Thanks for taking our question. We've unfortunately seen some relatively high numbers of deaths reported in the past couple of weeks. And I'm wondering if you can talk at all about what is behind that. Are these attributed to people who got infected with Delta weeks or even months ago? Or is Omicron behind this? And any sort of particular trends in terms of vaccination status or age groups?
Very good question, Allison. We're trying to do the same analysis and get you the answers for the questions you just posed. Many will be from the previous Delta wave that had severe virulence and higher death rates than Omicron. What we're also seeing is because Omicron is affecting so many people at once because of its high transmissibility, we will have a higher number of deaths associated with it, but a very small proportion of overall total cases. So I hope that's somewhat clear. It'll be a small percentage of a very large number is still a significant number of deaths. So I hate talking about death without recognizing that these are people's mothers, fathers, and family members. And my sincere condolences to anyone that's passed from COVID-19. I don't mean to be insensitive when we talk about these types of numbers. They are significant, and we're trying to get further, better data to understand as well. Now that we know roughly 45% of admissions to hospital are incidental to being diagnosed with COVID-19, and the same in the intensive care unit, roughly 20% are incidentally testing positive. It may be that some of these deaths are incidentally correlated to COVID-19. So we're trying to get the public better data and a better analysis to understand the true mortality associated with both Omicron and Delta as we go forward. And we've just recently met with the chief coroner's office. We'll be sending memos out to hospital partners to ensure that death is documented appropriately if it's associated with or caused by COVID-19 to further clarify for the public the cause of death.
Follow up.
Thank you. Yes, I'm also wondering what your thoughts are on whether Ontario should change the definition of fully vaccinated from 2 to 3 doses, either for reporting purposes like ICU occupancy or for vaccine certificate purposes. I know you've been asked this before, but I'm wondering if Omicron and the effectiveness of 2 doses versus 3 doses have affected your thoughts on this.
Oh, another good question. So thank you so much, Allison. We do want to ascertain that data, the level of protection of 1, 2, or 3 doses. So we're trying to collect that data in our case and contact management tools to understand the risk for hospitalization, to understand the benefits of vaccination. We have not made any recommendation to government to change the current a verification process for vaccination. That is one option that other jurisdictions are reviewing, but we haven't made that review as of yet or provided that as an option to government. But we will review what works around the world in terms of promoting vaccination and ensuring safety in public. Know that Quebec is entertaining the third dose as part of their verification process.
Last question.
From Jeff Gray at the Globe and Mail. Please go ahead.
Oh, thanks very much. Dr. Moore, I wanted to just follow up on yesterday. You made some comments and then issued a clarification about the issue of mandating vaccines in schools. The statement issued afterward, though, didn't quite get at the original question. So I wanted to ask you that again, which is why haven't we made it that we add COVID-19 to that list of other vaccines that school children are expected to have in Ontario?
Okay, so thank you for that clarification, Jeff. The Immunization Student Pupils Act, we need clarity. It has never been a mandatory vaccination policy. It is a mandatory reporting of your vaccination status. If you do not get vaccinated for, let's say, measles, mumps, or rubella, we would provide an educational opportunity. You could provide a medical exemption or a exemption for other purposes or reasons. That is the process in Ontario at present to document immunization. And historically, it's never been a mandatory. So I think there's some misconception of Ontario having a mandatory immunization policies. It's mandatory reporting. We have reviewed, including COVID-19 vaccination in mandatory reporting, but our health units have been so busy immunizing that we thought it could be an extra. You'd be suspended if you didn't report your status, but you can't. It's not mandatory immunization. Just for clarity, Jeff. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Okay. Yeah. No. Well. That's no. Appreciate that. No. But just to follow up, then, just I think what you said yesterday was that there was also a concern that if you're going to mandate a vaccine, but the novelty or the newness of this particular vaccine, is that not the case?
I think this vaccine is proving to be very safe and very effective. And so it has nothing to do with the safety or effectiveness of this vaccine. It does have to do with the mandatory nature of it, that there's no vaccine that's been made mandatory in Ontario. And I think that just needs to be clarified. I do believe that this vaccine is very safe and effective in preventing severe outcomes for children, and clearly is showing the same for adults as well. And we will review policy options over time and make recommendations to government over time regarding the reporting of the immunization status.
Thanks, everyone.